day, my brothers and sisters. I'd like to welcome you to JCC Sunday School's in session, where Sunday school matters to God. Please like, subscribe, and leave us a comment. JCC is a place where we are transforming lives, and we would love to hear from you. You can visit us at jordanchristiancenter.com or even follow us on Facebook, Twitter, or Instagram. Our lesson today is coming from Exodus 32, verses 15 through 24, and it's entitled, God Confronts Sin. Let's get into the lesson and see what the lesson has to offer us today. Verse 15 and 16 read, And Moses turned and went down from the mount, and the two tablets of the testimony were in his hands. The tablets were written on both sides, and on the one side and on the other side were they written. And the tablets were the work of God, and the writings was the writings of God, graven upon the tablets. Notice here, good leadership here. Moses immediately turns to go down and deal with the situation upon hearing about the children of Israel worshiping idols and going against God's covenant. We see that good leadership would always look to deal with things and take care of those things here real quickly, as he wants to get the people back on track. I thought it was also very ironic from a personal observation here. As we look at this here in this matter, in the Word of God, we see that the Word of God is in Moses' hands. The text says he had the written Word of God in his hand. And if I may, this is only an observation of the text, but it's striking to see in this observation. Every leader should be tackling the problem that arises with the Word of God in their hands. Having it in our hands is an illustration of having it readily available to use to combat disagreements, to provide it as a source, as a standard bearer for holy behavior. That's just a JCC nugget right there. This brings us to our first question, though. What is emphasized by the fact that the stone tablets Moses carried with him were inscribed by God himself? The text says they were handwritten on both sides. They were the work of God. And under the new covenant, God is still writing the law or his commandments to the day. Jeremiah 31 and 33 tells us, I will put my law in their minds and write it on their hearts, and I will be their God, and they will be my people. This is a promise of a handwritten word on our heart. God says by doing this, he will be our God, and we will be his people. Hebrews 10, verses 16 through 17 use the same verbiage as Jeremiah did, but it also adds an extra tidbit in verse 17 where it says, God will not remember our sins and lawless deeds anymore. So how does or when does God write his word on our hearts? It's when we accept his new covenant as born-again believers. It is then we become submissive to the word versus hostile to the word as we once were in our rebellious state. This means with the help of the Holy Spirit, as we read the word, we are inclined to believe and be obedient to it. So what can we learn from these two verses here? We can learn that in God alone, we have a perfect standard of morality and holy character. God still writes his word on our heart so we can live up to that holy standard that he has for us and become children of obedience to him versus children of disobedience. Verses 17 and 18 read, And when Joshua heard the noise of the people as they shouted, he said unto Moses, There is a noise of war in the camp. And he said, It is not the voice of them that shout for mastery, neither is it the voice of them that cry for being overcome, but the noise of them that sing do I hear. Joshua heard the noise again of the people as they shouted. And question two asks, what did Joshua think of the noise in the camp was? He thought it was war. As he heard that noise, he thought a war was going on in the camp. And please see this here spiritually with me. Although it was not a physical war, it was a spiritual battle taking place in the children of Israel, and they were losing this here battle, my brothers and sisters. Why were they losing? Because they had turned away from the Lord God and his instructions. They turned to the wickedness of the flesh. And here's the point I want to make on that. When we turn away and let our guard down from the instructions of God's word, we are going to experience the spiritual attacks of the enemy. And when we don't have the covering of God, we will be defeated in battle as we give in to temptation. Now, temptation is not a sin. Jesus was tempted when he was in by the devil for those 40 days and 40 nights. So we know temptation or being tempted is nothing wrong with that, but it is the decision to do wrong and the actions that follow that cause the sin to have a place to play. When we are tempted and we act on those temptations, then sin occurs. And how do we overcome that? We must submit to God, resist the devil so we can flee from temptation, so he will flee from us. Submission, my brothers and sisters, is the key. We must submit to the will and authority of the Holy Spirit as he guides us to make the right decision so we can overcome the temptations of the enemy. The enemy is going to attempt us on every side. So the people here did not focus on the instructions given at the mount, nor the consecration or the meditation God required of them to fully understand his will for their lives. No, they focused on themselves, and they wanted what they wanted versus what God wanted. They wanted to please the flesh and not please their God. Moses quickly corrects young Joshua by saying, it's not the cry of war, but a shout of spiritual wickedness. The reason I say it that way is because in the original language, he uses two words, varu and kalusha. These two words indicate that the sounds or the response in varu was not power or might. And that sound of weakness, meaning in Hebrew, kalusha, is not the weakness. What Moses is saying here is that it's not a human response, but rather a spiritual implication of the people. This was like a demonic uproar. Picture the scene. There was wild outcries, orgies, drunkenness, and people in an uproar. This was a breeding ground for wickedness at its best and a cesspool for sin. The people turned away from God and are now influenced by spiritual wickedness of their fleshly desires. That selfish desire to please the flesh had come about. And this here had caused them to get to a place where they committed idolatry. Idolatry is an invitation for demonic activity. The people physically acted out this spiritual demonic wickedness in their acts by worshiping and going through the motions of celebration in this worshiping this idol. In Hebrew, Moses says what he hears is ko'adnot, meaning this is a voice response I hear. Moses is saying I hear the verbal response of this spiritual wickedness. Please see here the positioning of the people. They were at a place where they were to worship God, but instead they worshiped an idol. We see now why God didn't want them to go get too close to the mountain, why he set up barriers to separate his holiness from the people. And why, you might ask? Because God knew their heart. Even though they agreed to follow God, even though they agreed to be obedient to all that God wanted them to do, he knew that sin was still lurking deep within them, and they will reject his commandments. Rejecting God's word always causes confusion. We should not be lured away by the immoral standards of our fleshly desires that will cause us to make decisions to sin. And once we give way to sin, it gives us an opportunity to go in and get further from our God versus getting closer. Verse 19 says, and it came to pass as soon as he came nigh unto the camp that he saw the calf and that the dancing, and Moses' anger waxed hot, and he cast the tables out of his hand and brake them beneath the mount. Let's dissect this here verse. This is a very important verse here. Moses came to a place where he could see the camp. And as he sees the people celebrating and worshiping this here idol calf, the people dancing, the people doing all immoral things, how Moses, it says Moses' anger waxed hot. Question 3 asks us, explain how Moses reacted to what he saw in the Israelite camp. The verse 19 illustrated it. Moses' anger waxed hot. Basically, Moses was 38 hot. He may have been thinking, how could the people who just made a covenant with God break the covenant so fast? The text goes on to say he cast down the tables of the law and broke them at the foot of the mountain. This very place at the foot of the mountain, the place that shows us the spiritual location of the people. They were not able to come up to the mountain again because of their spiritual conditioning. God knew the people's heart, and they were not able to come into the holy presence of God because of their spiritual conditioning. And Moses broke the law right there at that place. Question 4 asks us, why did Moses break the stone tablet? The breaking of the tablet was significant in that it was a significant ceremonial act. Moses didn't break them out of merely anger, but this was done to demonstrate that the breaking of these his tablets had been broken by the people already. Yes, he was angry, but the breaking of the tablets demonstrate the breaking of the covenant. See, a covenant is an agreement between two or more people, and it is a binding contract until someone breaks it. The actions of the people broke the covenant which they had made with God, and as a result, Moses symbolizes this here by breaking the tablets. This here was an illustration again and a symbolism to them as well as for us to see that when we break the covenant with God, it is null and void. The blessing promised to the people was only if they were obedient to the covenant. They had to be obedient to what God has said. And now this, we see sin, the sin of idolatry and immorality has shattered the covenant that was made with God. When we are driven to the passion of our flesh and do not obey the word of God, we will be in the same position as these here Israelites. We're in a place where we are disobedient to the word, and our spiritual conditioning will make way for demonic influences to come in and try to get us further from our God versus us being obedient and being closer to him. We can see that anger can be very destructive, but sometimes it's necessary. The Bible says we can be angry, but don't sin. So when we see the anger of Moses because of the people's action that's caused the destruction of the commandments on these his stone tablets, Moses is showing us that even though he got angry, he did not sin. He did not allow the anger to cause him to sin in spite of what the people were doing. There is a lesson to learn in that we may disagree or become very angry with the actions of others, but we're still required to hold the standards of God that God demands for us, and that is still not to sin. Let's look at verse 20 and 21. And he took the calf when they had made and burned it in the fire and ground it to powder and straw it upon the water and made the children of Israel drink of it. And Moses said unto Aaron, what did this people unto thee that thou hast brought so great a sin upon them? Now I'm going to address the next few questions out of order to kind of try to make sense of all this here. Let's look at question 7. What did Moses do to the golden calf? After Moses smashed the tablets, he now deals with the idol. The text says he took the calf and burned it. We know that fire is a symbolism for judgment. This was judgment against the sin of idolatry. This shows us if God's commands are broken, there will be a price to pay, and that price is judgment. He grinded the idol into a fine powder and sprinkled it in the water. Then he made them drink it. Question 8 says, why did he put the golden burnt powder in drinking water? This is to show that they had to suffer the consequences of their actions. The same holds true today in that sin has consequences, my brothers and sisters. Those who sin will have to suffer the consequences of their actions. Moses made them drink their God, basically. The very thing they wanted to worship, that gold now, had become defiled. And now that it has been defiled because it was made into a golden image, it cannot be used again, especially as we get on into the chapter and learn about the tabernacle in the future. By making them drink it, it would later be expelled from them as something now that has now become unclean and defiled. As a result, it would never be touched again by them. Now, drinking shows us also the desires of the flesh as our body desires water. The word of God is showing us here that the people surrendered to desires of their flesh. And as a result, the consequence of surrendering to their flesh, they would be reminded of it every time they drank of this here water. And this here water, I'm sure, was gritty and bitter. This gritty, burnt water would now be not so pleasing to quench a dire thirst. It's now bitter. It's now has a nasty bitterness to it. And the judgment of sin will leave a burned and bitterness from God's wrath with us. So when we give in to the desires of our flesh and sin, we will not be satisfied and we will be made to receive that which is not pleasing unto us. Question 6 asks, why did the people not resist the actions Moses took? They knew the favor of God was with Moses. Moses had God's authority, and the people did not want to test that authority. They had witnessed God speaking to Moses. God told them that when he spoke to Moses, they would know that he was with them. and they will respect him from that moment on. And we see here, they had seen the miracles that Moses had done, that God done through Moses, and now they did not want to go and challenge that authority. The Bible says, mess not with my anointed and do my prophet no harm. When the people can see the anointed and favor of God on one's life, they should deter and resist any aspect of wanting to go in and fight. They should come back and respect the sovereignty of God and the anointing he has on that individual. Question 5 asks, how does Moses' action contrast with Aaron? Moses destroyed the idol, whereas Aaron built an idol for the people. Moses stayed on the principles of God, whereas Aaron succumbed to the people's demands. We see here in good leadership and godly leadership, he would always stay on the side of God and not give in to the demands of the people. Question 9 says, how did Moses view Aaron's role in the idolatry of Israel? Moses asked Aaron a question. What did this people do to you that caused you to bring such a great sin upon them? He's basically saying it was Aaron's action that brought the sin to the people, and it was a great sin indeed. Now, Moses implies he understands the people could have suggested Aaron go along with this here act of building up this here idol. But he's also implying that, Aaron, you were the leader. And as a leader, you have a responsibility for your leadership. And if a leader hears the people versus hearing God, obeys the people instead, this is the problem in the church. That's why Moses asked, what could the people have done to make you do this? The results of this make you want to go this far, Aaron, to go in and cause this great sin to be cast upon the people. We know Aaron gave in quickly. He didn't put up any resistance. No, he was willing to give in. He wanted to go in and build it. He also even suggested having a celebration afterward. God expects leaders to resist the urge to go against his will. We can learn a life application here in that sin disappoints those whose hearts and minds are intent on pleasing God. Moses was disappointed at the actions of his brother. In Deuteronomy 9, I believe verse 20, we see that we know that God was even angry with Aaron and Moses had to intercede for him. Verse 22 says, and Aaron said, let not the anger of my Lord wax hot. Thou knowest these people, that they are set on mischief. Look at Aaron's response. He's supposed to be trying to cool off Moses, trying to get Moses not to be so angry at him. He says, the people have a tendency to do evil. He says, you know this right here. He's making an excuse on why he did what he did. We learn that leaders who fall must repent and turn to God instead of making excuses for themselves. We always need to get back on the right track. Aaron here is making an excuse on trying to put it on the people instead of accepting responsibility for himself. Verse 23 and 24 says, for they said unto me, make us gods which shall go before us. For as for this Moses, the man that brought us up out of the land of Egypt, we wot not what has become of him. And I said unto them, whatsoever in it go, let them break it off. So they gave it to me. Then I cast it into the fire, and there came out a calf. Question 10 said, what defense did Aaron initially offer for his participation in the nation's rebellion? He projected his sin onto the people. Notice this is how he set it up in that last verse. Moses, you know for yourself, these people are prone to evil. He tried to make the people be the blame for him doing what he did. He wanted to minimize his role, the role of a leader who went so far as to make the idol that the people worship. He also was the one who planned again the celebration that followed after it. Aaron goes on to further his case on why he didn't do what he did. This again was a weak excuse. It was a weak, sorry excuse for a leader. He says they wanted gods to go before them. Yes, they did want gods to go before them. They wanted to reject God's revelation because they wanted their own God. They wanted to do it their way. Man always has a tendency to always want to do things their way versus surrendering to the ways of God. But Aaron was the leader. And as the leader, Moses is pretty much implying, even though he didn't say anything, it's almost implied when he left that you always got to stand on the word of God. He says, notice what he says. He said, I just casted it, that gold into the flame, and it came out a calf. Aaron condemned himself with his own words. The point in that is that the mature leader needs to stand on God's word, to stand whenever public pressure is pushing against him. He needs to always maintain an accountability to God and realize he does not have an accountability to man. He needs to go in and do the right thing always with God. If he maintains accountability with God, it will manifest that accountability back to man. We can see from this lesson here that God will hold all accountable for the sins they commit. Sin will be judged, my brothers and sisters, and as a result, those who sin will pay the consequences for it. There was symbolism in this lesson that it showed us with the drinking water, with the gold being cast into it, with the breaking of the tablets, and various other things. We also see that it showed us the consequences of these here actions when they sin. We learned that leadership must take ownership of their sins and not point the finger at anyone else. God mandates that leadership must stand on the word and not bow down to the desires of the people. We can apply to our lives the need to strengthen our daily awareness that our thoughts and actions are seen and elevated by God. This has been a great lesson today, my brothers and sisters. I pray that we see how God confronts sin, how God uses his agents, his representatives to confront sin. And as we get into this here, a continued lesson in Exodus, I want to thank you for taking the time to listen to this whole lesson today. I pray it's been a blessing to you and those whom you may share it with. Again, check us out at joyandchristcenter.com, where we are transforming lives, and follow us on Facebook, Twitter, as well as Instagram. You can find all that information, our social media addresses down in the description. Till next week, come back next week, same time, same channel. Be blessed now.